Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to today's Copper Spotlight. I'd invite you all to please come on in and take a seat, and don't be afraid to sit in the front rows. Thanks very much. My name's Joe Pickard. I'm ISRI's Chief Economist and Director of Commodities. We've got a wonderful panel of experts for today's Copper Spotlight, so we're really excited about this one. Before we get to the main program, I'd like to introduce Mike Potash, who's just got a couple of quick words about ISRI's SARIA program. Mike?
Thanks, Joe. And welcome to the third edition of the SARIA Pitch Program. I'm here as chairman of the SARIA Task Force with a commercial message. When CERCLA was enacted, it created Superfund, which involved legitimate scrap processors doing legitimate scrap processing because it didn't adequately distinguish between scrap and waste. ISRI members and staff worked long and hard, and one of the big success stories ISRI can claim is the passage and subsequent signing by President Clinton of the Superfund Recycling Equity Act, lovingly known as SARIA. SARIA offers scrap processors some protection against Superfund if certain steps are taken, including selling a valid commodity at a market rate and performing due diligence to ensure that the consuming facilities to whom you ship material is handling their materials and their functions in an environmentally correct way. The last item is kind of difficult to achieve. As I explained before, not too many of us are willing to walk into a steel mill with a clipboard and say, I'm here to check you out. So, what the alternative would be to hire a consultant to go and check on this, do the investigations, write a report, and then you've got that report on file proving that you investigated them. But the hiring of a consultant can run at least $500 per report. So one of the good benefits of being an ISRI member is being able to obtain these reports through the company that ISRI has contracted with. ISRI has lined up an independent firm to research and write reports for members for any consuming facility they want. The commonly repeated reports are being billed to members at $15 per report. And the unusual ones that don't get more than a few repetitions or requests are billed at ISRI's cost of $300. Per report. Before any report is performed and any bills are sent, you're given a quotation on how much each report will be, and you've got the option to elect to select or not select that particular report or any or all of them. We expected a very large response when we set this program up, but we're only getting about 20 to 25% of our members responding. And we're not sure, but we suspect it's because you didn't know about it, so I'm here to tell you about it. We need to improve the participation in order to keep the cost down and keep the program going. The ordering period is once a year, and it's been determined that that's about the proper sequence or timing to check your consuming facilities annually. The open season for ordering reports is March 15th through April 30th. So we're coming up on the end of the season here at the end of this month. So what I would encourage you to do is go to ISRI.org. Find the little red guy with the shield being held up as protection against Superfund. Click on that and get your reports ordered. It doesn't make a lot of sense not to get these things given the price that we're charging. So to expose yourself to millions of dollars of Superfund when you might be able to help prevent it, doesn't make sense. So what I'm telling you is, while we can't guarantee that this program will protect you completely from Superfund, we're absolutely sure that if you don't do any due diligence and you don't take any steps, that you don't have any protection from it. So please help us out and let's participate in this. Thank you.
Mike, thanks very much for that update. Next, I'd like to introduce our moderator for today, Chris Greenfield of Federal Metal. Chris has been increasingly involved in ISRI's board of directors. And in my experience with him, I find Chris is just a wonderfully talented and genuine individual. He makes a great moderator for these ISRI events, and I'd like to welcome him back to the stage. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Chris Greenfield.
Thanks, Joe. I appreciate that. That was nice of you. That's the nicest thing anybody's said to me all week. I can't see it from here, but is my face right to the right? If so, I apologize. There's not a lot I can do with that side of it. My name, obviously, is Chris Greenfield, and I'm with Federal Metal. And coincidentally, this month marks the 100th anniversary of the Federal Metal Company, which is, I think you can all understand, in a family-owned business, a remarkable achievement. So we're very proud of that. David Noguski, who's our current chairman, he presided over Federal Metal through some of our toughest times, you know, the stagflation of the 70s and the contraction of the ingot-making industry in North America from 60 firms down to 8. He marks as his most significant accomplishment the successful handoff of the company from his father, Mark, to his son, Peter, who presides over the company today. But it's for those of you that work in or own family businesses, I think you can understand the significance. And furthermore, for those of you in the audience that have supported us over the years, we certainly thank you. We're going to talk about copper today, obviously, but we're going to take a slightly different tact. We're going to maintain our focus on copper, to be sure. You're going to learn about production and consumption. You're going to get a view of the future, just as you've come to expect from future spotlights. However, today, we're going to offer a slightly deeper perspective, a clearer lens, if you will, into the Chinese economy and how China is likely to impact copper scrap markets going forward. After all, there is only one economy in the world whose copper consumption today is higher than it was prior to the beginning of the Great Recession in 2007. We'll talk about economics, politics, the day-to-day business environment, and of course, regulation. In terms of format, I have asked each of our presenters here today to make a brief presentation, and when complete, we are going to immediately open up the floor to discussion, and we're very much looking forward to engage you, our audience, in today's panel. I, of course, have questions to ask myself, but don't need to monopolize this discussion. A very important piece of bookkeeping before we get started, there are antitrust notes sitting in the rows among you, and I suggest you get familiar with this. Andrew from ISRI is sitting here as well to make sure that during the question and answer period, we do not run astray. Specifically, we're looking to avoid discussion of individual company pricing, pricing differentials, markups, discounts, credit terms, marketing strategies, et cetera. So please be mindful of that as you're making your comments and asking questions later on. Our first presenter today is Carlos Risso-Petran. Carlos is an experienced economist and engineer with over 30 years of professional experience worldwide. He worked as an economic and environmental advisor for the United Nations. He's worked for development banks and governments, mainly in mining and oil-producing countries. In 2007, he joined the International Copper Study Group in Lisbon, Portugal, as head of environment and economics. IGSG is an intergovernmental organization that serves to increase copper market transparency and promote international discussions and cooperation on issues related to non-ferrous metals. Thank you, and help me welcome Carlos.
Good afternoon, thank you for having me here, and thank you to ISRI for inviting me to this, sharing with you some information about the evolution of the use and trade of copper and copper alloy scrap in China and also in the rest of the world. The first thing that I would like to share with you is the relation between the balance or the global balance of the copper market and the variation of the prices. As you can see, in the period of 1974 to 2012, there is a quite clear behavior that shows that when you have a deficit, you have a trend to have increasing prices. And when you have a surplus, you have certain trend for prices not to increase so much or to even decrease. So this is the history of the relation between the global balance between supply and demand of refined copper and the evolution of prices. So there's a significant outlier there that was 2006. That was the year when we observed a global shortage in mine production. Yeah, a year when the Chinese imports fell significantly, and it's 2006 in the top. But for the rest of the time, you see quite consistent relation. So when you have a tight market, yeah, prices tend to be affected. In 2011, the situation was, as you can see over there, a significant deficit in the supply and demand. Yeah. And in 2012, we moved to a very tight market. Yeah. And you can forecast what will happen this year based on that. Why price the refined copper price is so important for recycling? Well, if you look at here, you can see that the two main uses of a scrap, they move very closely with the price of refined copper. So it's relatively easy to forecast the global use of copper scrap based on what's going on with the refined price. You can see in yellow there the LME price, and in blue you can see the scrap that is directly melted by wire rod and brass mill producers worldwide. And then you can see in red the secondary refined production, that's basically the scrap that is converted in refined copper, yeah, the refined scrap. Yeah. And you can see clearly that there's a very strong historical correlation, and probably this correlation will continue in the future. So you can do your exercise for what's going on in the coming years based on this relation. Next. Well, I need to say something about China and the copper market, because what I put here is the demand of copper in the rest of the world in blue in 2002, and the demand and in China in red. Yeah? Look how tiny was the Chinese demand 10 years ago. And look what happened now. Yeah? The global use of refined copper in the rest of the world fell in volumes, yeah, in the last 10 years. And the Chinese growth increased. So you have a market, demand that is now over 20 million tons. And the driver is impossible more clear there. The next one, please. So to understand what happened with the supply side, how the producers, the miners and the recyclers, how they respond to this incredible expansion in the Chinese demand for refined copper, you can see that the main drivers of the response was the miner response. The miners have been delivering more refined copper to the market than the recyclers in the last 10 years. Yeah? 3 million tons more, yeah? Against only 1.5 million tons, 1.6 million tons more from the recyclers. So you guys need to move faster to get them. Yeah? So you can see that this gives you an answer. Yeah? There is a minor response, and it's higher than the recyclers. Yeah? So there's a lot of work to do on this. The next one, please. But something that has been driving the market significantly from the demand side is China. But there's a driver, very strong driver from the supply side. That is what happened with the capacity utilization of the mines. Yeah? This explains a lot. I put there the percentage of mine capacity utilization that used to be very high 10 years ago. Around 92% of the mine capacity was being used in producing mine copper. Yeah? But look what happened in the 10 years. This is the story. It has been reducing. Yeah? The utilization of the mines has been going down. Yeah? And, well, this is the story that we are living now. Yeah? and this has been a significant impact in the behavior of the price. Next one. Well, this is a story. But the closer story, what happened last year, is interesting to see. If you look at the mine production of concentrate and Electro 1 copper, SXEW, you can see that between 2009 and 2011, the monthly mine production was quite flat. The miners were unable to produce more than 1.4 million tons a month in the last 3 years. It was flat mine supply. But last year, something changed. Yeah? There was a significant increase in the mine production, in the global mine production, especially in the second half of last year. I have numbers till November, but now I can say that it was not less than 700,000 tons more of mine production coming to the market in last year. Yeah, the significant change compared with the previous 3 years. Next one, please. And well, the future. What I know about the future is about what the miners tell to us that will be, that the mine capacity will be. And the mine capacity, according to them, will increase very fast. And they tell me the same thing year after year. But what happened at the end of the day? Most of the projects are being delayed. Yeah, the future mine capacity is being delayed. Yeah, and but maybe this will be maybe this time will be different. 2013, they say 1.1 million tons more of mine capacity, and for 2013, and for 2014 maybe 1 million tons more. So 2.2 million tons more mine capacity in the next 2 years, okay, but a lot less mine production. Maybe 50% of that will be mine production. Yeah, and I can see, we can see the usual pattern of more projects delayed to the next year. Last year was from 2014 to 2015. This year we have a lot of delay from 2015 to 2016. So maybe they do it this year and next year. Maybe not. Yeah, because mining is a very risky business. Next one, please. Now have a look at the real use of copper, not the copper that is stuck in a warehouse supporting financial operation between some people that need money and other people that have money and they are asking some collateral. No, we will talk about the copper that's been really going to the smelter and really going to wire rod plants, to brass mill plants, yeah, that has been really used by the industry. If you look at the global picture, I don't have all the countries, but I have a few and we estimate a few others. Between 2007 and 2012, the picture for the rest of the world except China is ugly. China is the only country that has been using a lot more copper in their industry to produce wire rod products, brass mills, semi-fabricated products as copper tubes, copper alloy tubes. Yeah? Most of the big industrial producers of copper are using a lot less. Look at the US is 26% below 2007, et cetera. No? The only countries that we found that they have a significant increase are the last four in the table: Iran, Saudi Arabia, the United Arab Emirates, and Indonesia. But it's because they have new plants. Yeah? They just start the operating wire rod plants, mainly at a few brass mills. Yeah? But in the middle, everything is in red. So this is the picture of the global industrial use of copper. Yeah. The rest is demand, but this investment demand is other kind of demand. The next one, please. Well, in the case of the US, there I have the breakdown of the industrial use of copper, mainly fabrication by type of production. It's mainly wire rod, as you can see in red. Yeah. And unfortunately, in 2012, we didn't see a better picture than in 2011 or 2010. Yeah, the fabrication using refined and using scrap as a raw material is quite flat. Yeah, still there's no recovery in the semi-fabrication of copper and copper alloy products in the US. And the situation in Europe, I have numbers until October of last year. They're not going anywhere higher. Yeah? They're quite flat. So at least we can say that the use of scrap and the use of refine in Europe and the US is stable. Yeah? This is what the numbers say. The next slide, please. What happened in China? Well, I did a tricky thing here. First of all, I put all the copper that is produced in China. I can't see very well, but it's the first slide, and then the total copper use coming from Chinese mine and coming from Chinese scrap, yeah, has been growing. Yeah. Then I add the imports of different types of copper, refined, scrap, in copper content. I added everything for the last 3 years. And then I discount the copper that has been exported. Yeah, I discount the concentrate exporter, the semi-fabricated copper exporter. Yeah. So my next guesstimate of how much copper is available in China in the last 3 years, before 2012, gave me like 26.4 million tons. And then I compare with the copper content used by the industry. Yeah? That is basically a white rod in light blue. Yeah? A lot of copper alloy sheet and copper sheet tube and rod. And this is around less than 25 million tons. Yeah? So give me is 24.4. So a big guesstimate is that the Chinese had 3 more million tons than the one that they needed before 2012. Yeah? It's to have an idea of what happened with the Chinese availability and the real industrial use of copper in China. I hope you got it. The next one. Now, I took a look to the official Chinese numbers that are basically, they are produced not in copper content, but they are produced in gross weight. So I just put the numbers there. I do not do anything with the numbers. Just put it there in red, and I compare with Japan, Korea Republic, and Taiwan in terms of the fabrication output. You can see how important is the official Chinese fabrication compared with other countries in the region. But the Chinese numbers are in gross weight. They are not in copper content. Yeah? The alloys are included, no? Like zinc, tin, other metals. So we did some work in China with our consultants there, and we obtained these numbers of copper content in fabrication output that show us that the total use of copper in that industrial use, yeah, not warehouse use, yeah, is around 9.2 million tons copper. Yeah, so it's 1% more than in 2011. It's a very, very slow growth, if any. Yeah? And it's mainly driven by the white rod production. And then you have the copper semi-fabricated products. You have the copper alloy semis. And then you have a little bit of castings. Yeah, there's a lot of polemics about how much castings the Chinese are using. But I trust these numbers, yeah, because, well, we work on these numbers every day. So this is the picture. Our estimates is that the copper content in Chinese fabrication is a little bit, it's below 9.3 million tons. Yeah, and the official numbers are significantly higher. The next slide, please. I just show you here the Chinese copper industry. It's mainly fabricators. Yeah, 1,312 plants. 48% of the Chinese copper industry is copper only fabricators, yeah. And then we have the alloys, the copper alloy fabricator that they use a lot of scrap, especially copper alloy scrap, yeah. And they are like 27%, more than 700 plants. Yeah? Then we have smelters and refineries, more than 300 of them. Then we have mining companies, yeah, less than 300 mining companies, and yeah, the casting foundries that are around 100. So this is the picture of the companies existing in China this year. What will happen in the future? Well, with this structure, many people think that you will see more vertical integration between this huge number of companies and maybe less fabricators in the future. The next slide, please. One starting point to understand the real industrial use of copper in China is to have a look at what happened with white rod, because it's the main use of copper, refined copper and scrap, is used in the white rod production. The numbers of our studies show that around 5.8 million tons of copper was used to produce white rod last year. And then we have around 3.3 million tons in other copper uses that are not white rod, like brass mills, copper tubes, castings. So this is the picture of copper use for last year. And clearly you can see that they have a lot more capacity than the one that they are using. And most of this capacity is brand new. So they are not using a lot of the brand new capacity. Yeah? So it will be difficult to get with the yield on your capital with this behavior. And the trend is for a lot more capacity to come. Almost 13 million tons if the Chinese plants that are in the pipeline are delivered. Yeah? But you don't see a faster growth in the real white rod production. Yeah? The white rod production is expected to achieve 6 million tons this year. Yeah? So you have a terrible capacity utilization. Yeah? Imagine 50% of the capacity is being used for white rod. And well, for brass mills, we didn't do the numbers yet because we need to fund a big study. We don't want to do small surveys. So, but probably we'll find something similar. The next slide, please. So what happened with the scrap in China? Basically, two different things. If you look at the production of refined copper that is coming from a scrap, we see a significant increase. But when we look at the scrap that is directly melted by white rod plants and by brass mill plants in China, you see a collapse last year. Yeah? They used less 11% compared with 2011. Yeah? So they are using significantly less scrap in their direct melt process, and they are focusing all in producing refined. Yeah? So you may think that the refineries and smelter uses scrap are full capacity, but you will see that it's not the situation. The next one, please. What happened last year? Well, we all know here that the prices fell 10% last year. Yeah? Was a significant fall in the refined copper price. Yeah? What was the totally very predictable reaction of the Chinese importers? Well, you can see that they import concentrates, they import refined, but the value of the scrap import fell. Yeah? The volume increased a little bit. They import a little bit more of a scrap compared with 2011, but they pay less money for the scrap. That is quite clear there. And what happened with the spreads? The spreads are critical for the scrap business, probably everybody here knows. The spreads are terrible. The spreads have been bad for a long time. Look at the spread between refined copper, using the Shanghai price cash as a reference, compared with number one and number two scrap qualities there, you can see that the margins are very, very small. So with these margins, imagine this is the profit of your company if you are in a smelter refining copper. Yeah? You will not be happy with this profit. Yeah? The Chinese spread are the profits of the Chinese smelters and refiners. Yeah? So look what happened, the next one. What happened? Well, it's very reasonable. I put here all the smelters in China and refineries that they are using scrap as a raw material. So the picture is, as you can see, their capacity is more than 3 million tons, but the total amount of refined scrap that is being, the smelted scrap is a little bit more than 1.5 million tons. Yeah? And when you look at the refinery capacity, that is almost 3 million tons, you can see that the refined production is a lot lower. Yeah? And this is a real thing because they came from the factories by one. Yeah? So very transparent information. And not only that, we have the capacity utilization of the smelters is a little bit more than the capacity utilization of the wire rod producers. And the refiners are doing a little bit more. Yeah? But still it's 60%. So this is the situation of a lot of underutilization of the even brand new secondary smelting capacity in China because the spreads are too small. The profits are too small. So they don't have enough incentives to develop the scrap demand. And not only that, they are planning to, in the next 3 years, they are planning to deliver 1.2 million tons more of scrap smelting capacity to the pipeline. Yeah? So we'll have a significant increase in smelting capacity. Yeah? Hopefully we will have an increase in the refined production, in the smelted production coming from scrap. But what we see is not happening. So some of the reasons to invest in, why you invest in a scrap smelter in China. Yeah? Some people told us that they invest basically because the environmental approval is easier than for a concentrate smelter. Yeah? So if this is the reason why you invest, well, you have resources and you need to invest in something. Yeah? So they're investing in scrap smelters, but it doesn't mean that they're going to use it. Uh-oh. This is the next one. Next one, please. Yeah. I need to go fast. Well, I'm going to tell you that there will be some restrictions to the capacity. Yeah, some capacity will not be allowed. There is the detail for direct melt plants and for smelters. Next one, please. The total amount of scrap in China is around 3 million tons, mainly cathode from scrap, that is 1.8. Then you have a scrap in wire rod, that is 400,000, and a scrap used by brass mills, that is 750. So we have around 3 million tons. Next, please. The use of scrap in imports is less than 2 million tons, and the rest is domestic scrap. I hope our speakers, the next speaker will discuss more in detail this. Next one, please. I want to speak a little bit about the global scrap export that has been falling worldwide, but I have no more time, so I will say that it fell last year in 4%. Yeah, mainly the UK and the USA was the most affected regions in terms of scrap exports. Next one, please. Finally, I want to say that if you look at the spreads in the last 3 years, I have the first quarter of 2011, 12, and 13, you can see that all over the world, there's a decreasing availability of scrap if we trust that the spreads are revealing availability. Yeah? So in a world of decreasing availability, it's not surprising that the Chinese are investing more in copper alloy semi-fabricators because this is what they are getting more from overseas, and they are not getting enough domestic scrap now. And they are not investing as far as they used to invest in copper smelters, and I think I explained the reason quite clear. And the next one, please. And then if you want to know more about it, you can visit our website and have a look at our publications, studies, research, and statistics. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Carlos. Excellent. Very much appreciate that. Thank you, Carlos. Our next speaker today is Bob Stein. Bob has been active in the metals industry since beginning his career in 1973 with the London-based metals trading firm of Brandeis Goldschmidt Limited in their New York, London, and Tokyo offices. In 1980, he joined Commercial Metals Company of Dallas, Texas as a copper trader, and from 1984 to 2002, he was director of nonferrous metal for a major Michigan-based scrap concern. In January of 2003, he joined Ultra Trading Corporation and serves as its vice president of nonferrous marketing and trading with oversight of all the marketing, trading, and hedging activities of the company's domestic and international business in all nonferrous metals. Bob is president of the nonferrous division, Bureau of International Recycling in Brussels, Belgium, and is the former chairman of its ambassadors committee. He previously served as a member of the New York Mercantile Exchange COMEX division, Non-Ferrous Advisory Board, and has served as chairman of the Copper and Brass Division here at ISRI. Please join me in welcoming Bob Stein.
Thank you, sir. I'll talk really fast. Thank you, Chris. Thanks for having me here today, ISRI. It's a pleasure to be here. Let me just tell you, I'm speaking today as an employee of Ultra Trading Company, and anything I have to say has nothing to do with my position with the Bureau of International Recycling. So it's a pleasure to be here. I'm going to share some thoughts with you. I'm going to let you know who we are briefly, and to let you know from our perspective, as a shipper to China of quite a lot of copper scrap every month, certainly amongst other things, we have a view that might be a little bit different than less active participants in that market, and certainly could be different than what a lot of you very active folks have to say about it. Let me tell you who we are and where we are. Alter Metal Recycling, we're a 115-year-old company, privately owned. We now have our fifth generation of ownership active in managing the company, with 45 scrap processing yards in the states of Wisconsin, Iowa, Illinois, Nebraska, Minnesota, Michigan, Alabama, and Mississippi. We employ around 1,200 people with 10 shredders, a heavy media plant, ASR downstream systems, an aluminum furnace, and catalytic converter processing and blending facilities. In addition to our yard facilities, which handle all grades of non-ferrous and ferrous scrap, and various other specialty metals, our trading group buys metals from qualified outside sources for direct mill shipment around the world. The ferrous side of our business is a major supplier to the large mills of the United States, both as a shipper from our own yards and as a broker through its unique relationships with the consuming sector here in the United States and overseas. Our Hong Kong affiliate, Ultra Metal Recycling Hong Kong, sells our scrap in China and to other locations around Asia and acts as a regional transportation and trading hub. I'm telling you all of this because I do want you to understand our place in the trade. And I did get a haircut and put on a tie, and it's my idea of a commercial, so thank you very much. As part of my career, I lived in Dallas, Texas, and I used to love to go to the Texas State Fair every autumn. At the fair, there were lots of the usual games, throwing darts at balloons, knocking over bowling pins with a softball, etc. At each of the game booths, there was a warning of sorts, and although pertinent to the game at hand, also very pertinent to our business, as well as many others. It simply read, "If you don't understand the game, ask the clerk. If you still don't understand the game, don't play." And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that game today. We do play, and it's a difficult game to understand, and especially to those of you who who know that sometimes the rules of the game seem to change between periods or at halftime or between innings, whatever your choice of sports is. So the subject matter at hand today is copper scrap and the China market. And I'm going to attempt to capture the current situation, and I'm going to share with you what I see for the future. I'm going to do this by telling you first what I would normally share with you last, and that's that I believe that the enormous appetite that China has had for our copper scrap over the past 20 years or so has, in my opinion, reached its zenith, and it's important as a market option for us is going to decline over time to the point that it will join other importers as a mature and steady customer for our scrap. Arguably, refinery capacity in China continues to grow, and the demand for copper will continue to exist, but China is using more copper concentrates as a percentage of its total copper imports, for example. And I think some of the slides that Carlo showed might bear out my theory there. Domestic scrap in China is going to play a larger part of the market share as that country industrializes. And the use of copper will vary among applications, among the smelters and the consuming fabricator sectors, depending on scrap's worldwide value, especially obviously against copper cathodes. Issues of compliance, fast-changing regulatory implementation, and irregular policy enforcement, along with the scars that still remain from performance failures on the part of the some market participants in late 2008, have and will continue to place impediments in the way of meaningful sustainability. Together with some economic matters surrounding infrastructural growth and economic bubbles, the Chinese market could well be challenged to maintain its place as a paramount choice of destination for sellers of copper scrap, and in fact, that process has begun. I'll spend a few moments with some thoughts about why, but there's no single issue that will contribute to this, but a combination of commercial as well as political and practical reasons for what I have to say. And my hope is that this generates some comments and some arguments or discussion. But coincident with the demise of the secondary smelting utilization, at least, of copper scrap in the United States, came the beginning of an age of industrialization in China that continues to this day. There were three primary reasons that secondary smelter capacity failed, or its utilization failed in this country. Inflation, environmental compliance, and the fact that the United States was self-sufficient in copper. The first two of those three criteria exist today in China, and I'll touch on that in a second. Buying copper scrap primarily for infrastructural growth, it became the market that eventually determined what the world was going to pay for copper scrap. It still holds that position. But let's take a look at what's going on here and there in respect to some of the issues that can make it tough to favor that market over others when it comes to selling our scrap. Copper, just like every commodity, finds its way to points of consumption through the path of least resistance. Each obstacle to that flow, each impediment, in whatever form that might be, adds costs, inhibits efficiencies, and provides incentives for scrap to be shipped elsewhere unless those extra costs to get the material to market are somehow recouped by us, the sellers. In today's world, and especially in today's China, the cost of doing business, of getting those pounds of copper scrap to market, are high. And the cost of supplying copper scrap to China, attributable to compliance issues, are the highest that I know of in the world. To the exporter, it's just arithmetic. There's no emotion to this. Does doing all of this make sense? Can I sell my copper scrap for less elsewhere in the world and still come out ahead? Oh, CCIC, AQSIQ, in front of a green fence. Now, I don't know if that's the green fence, but it is a green fence. It is the green fence. That's the one. Okay, thanks, Adam. China has a duty and a sovereign right to protect its environment and its citizens from hazardous materials. As part of the objective of keeping harmful goods from being exported to that country, it requires shippers to obtain clearance from CCIC, the inspectorate that is charged with overseeing the environmental and safety aspects of scrap being sent to that country. In principle, it's a good thing, but it's a cost to shippers, and it adds a level of administrative oversight and burden that can, for a number of reasons, be problematic to the efficient movement of our scrap. In addition, direct shippers to China need to have current license from AQSIQ, renewable currently every 3 years, in a process that's both confusing and difficult for exporters to undertake. Costs to do this are high, and the maintenance of the license is subject to ongoing shipments to China that are not rejected, nor for environmental or for safety reasons. And while no shipments from any of our companies, regardless of destination, should incur such rejections, it can be difficult to know what current policies in China might be, when they might change, and of course, the financial downside of suffering a rejection. This represents costs that shipping to other countries doesn't always attract. As I said at the outset, I believe that China, or any other country for that matter, has the right and an obligation to protect its land and its people. This level of oversight and regulations is by no means unique to China. Take a look at all of the folks who want you to check with them before you export scrap. Not at all unique to China, but I throw it in as a matter of information as to what you need to do with your international shipments. There may be a few countries which aren't on the list, but you have from various United States government entities, the Department of Commerce, the Department of Justice, Homeland Security, all of these lists need to be reviewed when you enter into a contract with a foreign entity. The one at the very bottom, the National Technical Information Services, compiles all of this. Your freight forwarder should be doing this for you, but the responsibility is to you as the shipper to make sure that your thick-walled aluminum tubing is not ending up in North Korea at a nuclear plant or something. And for those of you who are involved with agents overseas, the FCPA, the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, monitors things such as bribing foreign officials. Even if you don't have any knowledge of it, they are your agents. They are you in that country. Companies like ours vet our foreign agents. It can cost anywhere from $5,000 to $20,000 to make sure that these people are legitimate, that they don't have previous violations, and that we can in no way suffer harm from the actions they take on our behalf. Tremendous amount of oversight. So let's talk a little bit about inflation, and I touched on it a little bit earlier. So what else deters from China's prominence as a major force of scrap? Well, it's their costs. As with any country in a state of development, labor costs increase. In the case of China, they continue to rise as its populace demands consumer goods, a decent standard of living, clean air and water, and all of the good things that are available to the industrialized world. Inflation is a great equalizer when it comes to trade. The advantage of cheap labor that China once enjoyed is going by the wayside. When I first did business in China, scrapyard laborers made about $80 a month. They also were given room and board. Today, that's $400, $500, or $600 or more. As a result of inflation, China looked to mechanization, just as we do here in the United States. Wire choppers have replaced hand stripping or illicit burning of insulated copper out in the backwoods at night. Heavy media separation plants have replaced hand picking of shredder residues. What that means to us is simple. If it only takes three or four people to run a chopping line, perhaps more in the case of a media plant, the huge savings vanish. That labor advantage goes away because the incremental cost of treating those materials in the United States don't increase dramatically. China loses its competitive edge. So I would maintain that inflation and also the resultant mechanization is another reason in support of my theory. Well, we can't nor should we forget what happened to our industry in 2008 when the financial crisis had buyers in China walk away from their obligations. Keep in mind that many buyers kept their promises and performed on every aspect of their contracts. Today, we still have some of our smaller customers paying us back for each container that we ship to them some 5 years later. While it's never fair to equate the performance of everyone in one market with the worst of its players, the situation 5 years ago created a nervous atmosphere that has, to this day, and likely for a long time, continued to lurk in the background of business in that country. Suppliers charge deposits, have established rather dynamic pricing criteria that disallow Chinese customers to speculate with material that's been contracted for and might be on the water. All of this takes administrative oversight, and it's not cheap. It's a practice that's not common to almost all other scrap destinations. It also means that for copper scrap, large hedge accounts need to be maintained along with financing of margin and compensating margins. Our company has millions of dollars tied up in this very way. So the third point in my argument is, if you will, performance. The last topic to support this is really back of the envelope economics. China, like its Asian neighbors, has been a major consumer of copper and copper scrap alloys for infrastructural growth. In its first generation, after its decades-long experiment with a communist economy, China's infrastructure continues to expand. It's being built up quickly, too quickly, some would say. Large commercial projects in Tianjin stand empty. Many residential communities the same, and we've heard of a number of projects that have been stalled or canceled due to financial problem. It's as if the country has built not necessarily because of real demand, but because of apparent or anticipated demand, and at some point, that's going to slow down and less of our copper scrap will be needed. In addition, the massive stocks of copper being held in warehouses in China, either on or off the Shanghai Exchange, are an overhang that can't be ignored. Much of it is being collateralized for loans, mostly with foreign banks who have cheaper money to lend than Chinese banks. And if that ever comes to the market, as it shall at one point, the demand for our scrap will be further compromised. In these very short comments, designed to encourage some comments and participation from you, I make a case for some challenges that our export scrap business with China faces. China will always continue to be a strong force, most certainly. But the sea change brought about by its recent enforcement of policy under the banner of the green fence will, together with the issues I've addressed, cause exporters to seek more efficient business elsewhere. As China approaches its yet elusive levels of sustainability in industrial, economic, and environmental matters, it risks alienating its supply chain of copper scrap as sellers seek cheaper and more efficient markets in which to sell their materials, with underlying performance at all levels of transactions paramount to an atmosphere of trust and efficiency. And there's one thing I just want to add in conclusion. A number of you have experienced theft of material out of your containers bound for China. Some of it probably occurs in China. Quite a bit of it points to a transshipment of a scrap in Hong Kong, where it's believed that organized gangs are stopping containers en route from the ships to the terminals. The Bureau of International Recycling, as a member of the International Chamber of Commerce, through the International Marine Bureau, which sits in London, has an agreement whereby BIR members can report thefts with all of the details. It's completely confidential. And with an idea to trace where these goods are being stolen, to identify hot flash points where the thefts are occurring, how it's being done, etc. The only way they can really do it is with a large database. At the executive committee meeting of the BIR 3 weeks ago, we decided that it would be great if ISRI, because of its very large membership, would participate in this plan. And you will, as ISRI members, either have a link to the ISRI web page or somehow be involved in reporting your thefts. We will produce some data that should help you in deciding how to best protect yourselves, whether it's through using various different shipping companies, using circuitous routing to get your material where it needs to go, the use of heavy-duty locks, which our company has been using for a number of years. Ironically, they're made in China. But that's available to you as ISRI members, so please, that hasn't been announced before now, feel free to use it. So with that, I've spoken enough. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bob. Great.
Thank you, sir.
Much appreciated. Thank you very much, Bob. Very, very informative and lots of great perspective. Our third and final speaker this afternoon is Adam Minner. Adam is an American writer based in China, where he serves as the Shanghai columnist for Bloomberg Worldview. In addition, his work has been featured in The Atlantic, Slate, Foreign Policy, The Wall Street Journal, and other publications. As a scrap industry journalist, Adam has filed dozens of dispatches from China, Asia, and the world, explaining the big trends and the minutiae that makes our industry work. On May 12th, Bloomsbury Press, the people who brought you Harry Potter, will publish his first book, Junkyard Planet, an exploration of the scrap industry, globalization, and the journey from your recycling bin to the world. I also want to add as my own anecdote, Adam has a Twitter account, at Adam Minner, which I highly recommend you follow. I've been doing this for the last several months, and I've learned more about what's going on the ground in China from that than everything else. Please welcome me in joining Adam Minner. Thank you.
I know it's getting very late in the day, and it's getting towards the end of what this session should be, so I'm going to truncate what I had planned to do, but one of the things I planned to do was just put up a scrap photo, because I've sat in on most of these spotlights, and I think it's been all charts, and it's a scrap convention, for goodness sake, so let's have some scrap photos. I'd like to touch a little bit on fundamentals of the Chinese economy, because copper, even though we know it's been decoupled because of financialization, there's still some very important fundamentals that I think have been misconstrued, misunderstood on a very wide basis in the United States and amongst the industry. When I talk to my friends who are in this industry, I get a few questions, and number one is housing. I think everybody has seen at some point these images of the ghost cities of China, and that sets off red lights for a lot of people. I think, Bob, you just alluded to them. I want to touch on this for a moment because I think there's been a great misconception about what those mean. China's real estate market is not the U.S. real estate market. It is not a leveraged real estate market. If you want to buy a home in China, you have to put down cash. Now, the question is how much cash? Depending on the municipality you're in, it could be anywhere from 40 to 60%. Now, people who put down 40 to 60% on an apartment usually don't renege on it, and that's been the case in China. The default rates on home mortgages are very low. Now, what does this have to do with something like Ordos, which is the infamous ghost city of Inner Mongolia that we've seen in 60 Minutes? You heard on National Public Radio. Ordos was built with cash. Ordos itself is a coal mining region out in Inner Mongolia. It hit the jackpot 10 years ago, and they decided to use that money, pay cash, and build a city. There's no problem with them defaulting on those loans, and the people who are buying those are paying cash for them as well. So I just want to bring this out as sort of an introduction, a way to help you think about China a little bit in the way that I think about it. I know a lot of people are talking about a China slowdown, and that gets people very worked up about the idea of more decline, not just in copper prices, but in other metal prices. I would argue that we are not going to see a China slowdown. We're seeing a temporary slowdown, and that has more to do with politics than it does to do with anything fundamental in the market. As most of you know, China had a leadership transition that started really last year in the spring, but formally happened in November and March of this year. Leadership transitions are politically tendentious periods. When they happen, the patronage and the infrastructure spending that is so important to doing politics in China gets cut off. I'm not going to give my friend Joe Pickard there the financing for a highway until I know who my boss is going to be and whether I'm going to be in trouble for giving him that. And so over the last 9 months, there's been very, very little infrastructure spending from the national government. And you hear over and over, if you go to the scrapyards in China, nobody's building infrastructure. Now, that's a little bit of an exaggeration, but it's very, very important. And it's going to change come late summer once Xi Jinping has the rest of his people in place. And we're going to see the faucets come on. And you're going to see a very, very large stimulus. And that should stimulate real copper demand. That's going to go on for a long time. For the last 2 years, as it became obvious Xi Jinping was going to become president of China, there's been floated a proposal for a $6 trillion stimulus package in China. And the goal of that, from 2013 to 2020, is to move China from a 51% urban society to a 60% urban society. That's more than 100 million people that they are going to move into cities. Now, that's not going to be just direct government spending. They're going to restructure their financial system in the process of doing that. China right now, believe it or not, doesn't have bonds. It doesn't have municipal bonds. They're going to develop that over the next few years, and I think you're going to see tremendous demand, not just for copper, but for the other metals that have made this industry go. I wouldn't call myself necessarily a bull on China. I've been there 10 years. I know too much about what can and can't go wrong. But when they decide to do these kinds of programs, they tend to do them. And I think that bodes very well for this metal and this industry in general. Briefly, then, let's just talk a little bit about scrap. Some of the things that Bob alluded to in regard to what's going on in the scrap industry, I think I'll pass over. I just took this 2 weeks ago in Ningbo, a wire processing yard there. The only thing to keep in mind about this, something I think is one of the most important trends in this industry in China, is that it is consolidating. There is no longer, you know, the little mom-and-pop yard that's actually able to, is and can buy the imported scrap. There have been cracked downs on licensing, especially in the Foshan area. If you want to import scrap, you're going to have a license and you're going to need a paper trail. As a result, the yards are getting bigger. And I think anybody in this room who trades with those yards knows it. You know you're dealing with bigger people. It's just not small anymore, okay? That has a few very important implications. These bigger yards pay their employees more, as Bob said. You know, when I first started visiting these yards 10 years ago, it was $80 to $100, for a laborer. Now we are up to $500. These women in this photo were making about $600 a month, and they're actually in the market for homes. That's incredible. In fact, the price of scrap labor has gotten so high in many cases, and I always ask this now when I go to scrap yards, the price of the laborers, the starting laborers, are making more money than the college graduates who are just moving into the office jobs. Think about that. So there are significant labor shortages for this sort of semi-skilled labor in China right now. It's a very, very important factor. We're going to get back to this photo in a second. Gonna move ahead. Mechanization. This is meatball shredding at the same yard. More and more mechanization. Those meatballs are shredded and they are run over there's a drum magnet, just spins around, gets the ferrous out, and they'll use some of that'll be handpicked. They've even started using eddy currents for this stuff. What that does is it increases the efficiency of the yards. And when you increase the efficiency of the yards, you increase the efficiency of the markets, especially when you have fewer yards, and the margins get tighter and tighter and tighter. Everybody in China lately is complaining that the scrap is too expensive. I tell them that's as much their fault as it is the fault of Bob Stein, and they don't believe me. So let me move on to the next image. Something that I learned just 2 weeks ago in Ningbo, this is what we were just at. I just have a question for the audience here. We see the cable. Everybody in here, I think there's a lot of people know what the price of that cable is. At the lower part of the photo, it's insulation, long stripped insulation. Who knows what that insulation is worth? Anybody? Yeah, it's tough, but anybody know just in general what the price of that is? Yeah, I mean, we're talking about 2,000 renminbi a ton. That's a little over $300 a ton, and you're giving it away for free. When I talked to the yards down in Ningbo this last couple weeks, they're saying that now the insulation has become their margin because things are so tight on the copper. I don't know how you start making money off that insulation, except if you want to start slicing it yourself, but that's a pretty amazing development when you think about it. And I think it's something you're going to need to be thinking about as time goes on. We all know what this is. There's a water table, not a very good one because you can see the copper's floating off into the insulation. That shredded insulation in Ningbo, roughly 600 renminbi a ton, which is just under $100. Again, these are real commodities, this mixed plastic, and it's becoming very, very important to the people who are processing this stuff in China as they find that their margins on the copper is getting very, very tight. Let's talk about domestic supply. I love this photo. I took this last fall. This is in Milo, which I'm guessing none of you have ever heard of. You've heard of Hunan Province. This is rural Hunan Province, about halfway between Changsha, the capital, and Yuyang, the second largest city. Cities collectively about 20 million people. And these are a small percentage, and I just want you to know, I just to make my point clear, this is the other side of the warehouse. These are just a few of the televisions that have been generated there in a two-month period. What does this tell us? I mean, it tells us there's a lot of people getting rid of their televisions in, you know, big cities in what some people would call secondary, some would call tertiary provinces. This isn't Shanghai. So this kind of supply is coming online, and it's real. How much copper is in there? You know, I don't know. The Chinese government estimates on the domestic supply of scrap in China, copper, are really poor. In 2001, they said collections were 300,000 metric ton, maybe. Last year, they're saying 1.2 million metric ton, maybe. Some of this, some of these televisions are still working. I suspect, based on a trip I made to India last month, that some of these are actually being exported out for reuse. It's going to be very hard to track what's happening. But this is going to offer, and this is very low grade, this is going to offer some competition and some relief for Chinese tired of importing your scrap, and it's going to be a growing wave. And these are just televisions. We aren't even talking about the automobiles yet. Okay, last thing, because I want to talk about Green Fence. I don't know if any of you have this app. This comes off my phone. What this is the second app I look at every morning. It's actually a Chinese app that gives you the air quality, here it is, it's on my phone, the air quality for 150 cities in China. This has sold millions of copies, 99 cents for this puppy. Okay, you can see it gives you the rating for the U.S. consulate, and below it gives you the Chinese government rating. In both cases, this is bad. Salt Lake City, this is the AQI. Salt Lake City, which is, you know, they're claiming to have some of the worst air quality in North America, they get alarmed when its numbers get up around 60, 70. You know, and this is actually, for my wife and I, we would consider this a good day where we could go out and take a walk, enjoy the weather. I've seen it much, much worse. Just this past fall, it was up at 700-800 in Beijing, which is considered hazardous for human health. The reason I bring this up, not only because it's a cool app, but it is because it just gives you a small sense of how serious the environmental situation has become in the mind of the Chinese public, and it's become politically important. Okay, it's not just a matter of, well, the air is bad, but now people are picking up on it. You know, for people who can't afford this app, they just have a desktop PC at home. Every morning, a guy by the name of Pan Shiyi, who has 15 million followers on Sina Weibo, which is sort of the Chinese Twitter, he broadcasts that image for Beijing, okay? And it gets retweeted hundreds and hundreds of times. It's causing a problem. So when we talk about Green Fence and we talk about what Xi Jinping is doing, you have to keep in mind that there is genuine political pressure that actually is calling into question the legitimacy of the Chinese government as it now stands. If they can't fix this stuff, if they can't at least do cosmetic things to fix this, they're going to have a real problem and a real crisis of legitimacy. And that's in part what's going on with Green Fence. Now, I don't take Green Fence very seriously. I think it's a worse case of what we've seen many times before. I heard somebody yesterday talk about every July and August, there's some kind of crackdown at the ports in Guangzhou. It's kind of what we're getting right now, only it's much worse because we've just gone through a 10-year leadership change, and you have all kinds of new government officials who don't know who they're answering to, but they all want to impress the new administration. Sooner or later, somebody is going to read them the Riot Act and say, actually, we need this metal, and we're going to have to start letting this stuff in. But I wouldn't want to underestimate how serious they are, when I say they, the Chinese government and Xi Jinping, to at least put Band-Aids on this, cosmetic Band-Aids, and at some point they're going to have to deal with this stuff very seriously. So, you know, as a long-term prognostication, you know, I spoke to somebody, a very large exporter of low-grade from the U.S. who actually owns yards in China, and he told me he thinks that the age of low-grade scrap exports to China is coming to an end. You know, they're going to start up again in the fall, he feels, but, you know, 5-10 years out, that's probably not going to happen, and it's going to have as much to do with perceptions of what that scrap is as it is to the reality of it. So that's a very, very truncated version of what I wanted to say to you today. And thanks, Joe, for inviting me. And thanks to this audience for always giving me a good reception. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Adam. Am I mic'd up? All right. I'd like to open up the, we have a few minutes here before the end of our session. I'd like to offer the opportunity for the audience to ask questions. Mr. Snyder? Why don't you get us started?
Mr. Stein.
That's me. Sir.
I don't think you addressed it properly about how to reduce your risk in China. In my previous life, I had about 40-some million reasons not to give them any credit, like reneges on deals in 2008. So the way we handle our risk is we don't ship anything to China without cash in advance, wire transferred into our account, acknowledged by our bank. That is the only way I know how to handle risk in China, because once I get my money and the container is shipped, if the boat sinks, it's not my problem.
Well, I'm not sure if that was a question or a statement or both, Larry. First of all, you cannot impugn the reputation, the quality of your whole country based on some bad experiences. We had bad experiences, too. I
had some good ones, but 40-some million dollars of write-downs.
Okay, well, I can tell you we were considerably more fortunate than that, and given our volume, our losses were, I won't say minimal, but significantly lower. And in reality, a shipper in the United States can cover the Chinese market by selling in the United States to local buyers or in methods like that, but you're getting a fraction of the market. You're not getting a broad a swipe at what is going on in that market. Now, there are pricing mechanisms, there are deposit mechanisms that work because we employ them and we use them and we're very strict.
There's nothing better than 100%, Bob. 100% is always better than 20 or 40% deposit. I'd rather have the money, the accounts receivable paid off in full immediately. There's no way anyone could ever justify letting any business go with just deposits, either being 20 or 40%. I had that argument for many years. 100% always beats 20 or 40% deposit.
Yeah. Right. We're going to move on if you don't mind. Thank you very much, Larry, for your perspective there. I want to change the subject here I love made-up words, Adam. And I like made-up words, especially when they talk about things that may or may not exist. Mm-hmm. The word I want to talk about today, we heard about in our economic forum this morning, it's reshoring. Mm-hmm. It's become... a lot of people have optimism that manufacturing jobs are returning to the United States owing to some of the higher costs of regulation and labor, et cetera, in China. What's your perspective on that? What are you seeing on the ground in China?
Yeah, I think it's wishful thinking. I mean, certainly there is some coming back, but if you start with the major manufacturers, say a General Motors, or even for Japan, a Honda, a Toyota, a Nissan, General Electric, they aren't coming back. And the reason is because they have those plants there to service the Chinese economy itself right now. And their suppliers are still moving, into China. And it's not going to change. I know of a company I wrote about recently, Minnesota Rubber. They make gaskets. Mm-hmm. Minnesota Rubber, they started in Minneapolis. Who cares? Most of their production now is in China. And why? Because that's where most of their business is, because they're serving a gasket market, that serves the largest automobile market in the world. I mean, you got to remember that. China's number one for automobiles right now, number one for computers. So why on earth would you move your factories from China back to the U.S.? Certainly there's sort of boutique industries or industries that may want to serve the U.S. market, which is still considerable better. But in general, this is not a trend. People are not uprooting to go from China back to the U.S. It's just not happening.
Mark?
Thanks, Chris. I'm really curious about the buildings that have been built over in China and the perspective of the speakers up here. I'm not so focused on the ghost cities as I am the peasants that take whatever money they have and put it into a building in Shanghai. Mm. And it's a non-producing asset. And in my country or here, in our country, if we take and we put money into a non-producing asset, it's a foolish move.
Right.
What is your perspective on, is this just me making stuff up, or is that a significant problem?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things I was going to talk about and I didn't is, the meaning of the Chinese real estate market is quite different than the meaning of the U.S. real estate market. In the U.S., you get a job, you make a little bit of money, and what's the first thing you do? You get a car, then you move up to a house. Entire families save up to buy a house, you know, an apartment for their single grandson, because we have a one-child policy. Like the first one-child children, one child per family is now 34. So a whole family will concentrate its assets into there. And that goes back many hundreds of years. You are not considered suitable for marriage until you own a home as a young man. So that's the real driver there, is these cultural factors. There is insatiable demand in China now to have homes. And it doesn't have to do with, you know, rational economic sense. These are cultural factors that drive people into this. So they're not thinking about it as a non-performing asset. They're thinking of it as a cultural prerequisite to certain, you know, social statuses, if you will.
Yeah, I would like to say something about it. I don't think it's cultural. I think it's very rational decision, because I'm from South America and I live a few financial crises, like the one that you live here in 2008 and the one that the Europeans will live soon. So with the experience I have about financial crisis, yeah, I think it's very easy now to have a physical asset, wherever it is, yeah? And that's why you are in the countryside and you say you get your money and you put in a physical asset, wherever it is, a house, an apartment in Shanghai, a cathode in a warehouse, gold. Look at India demand, yeah? So you do it because you don't trust central banks in the long term, yeah? And yeah. This is quite the rational behavior. Look at the history of the value of money.
Yeah, and you know, it's worth looking. I mean, these assets, I mean, what housing has done in Shanghai, just Shanghai, over the last 10 years is extraordinary. When I moved there in 2002, you could buy property in the center of the city for 3,000 renminbi per square meter. I wish I could convert that to dollars for you. But, you know, right now, the average price of a square foot in Shanghai is around 27,000. Renminbi, you know. Some people say that's out of whack. And you know, it's even higher in Beijing. I disagree. I mean, you think of a place like Shanghai in Beijing, those are the two largest cities and the second largest economy in the world. They should be expensive, like a New York, you know? And it's just everything sort of happens in China a little quicker. You know, that's my perspective on it.
I think, Adam, if I could just ask something here, because if you buy an apartment in Shanghai, you're talking about a multiple of 40 to 50 times your annual income to buy the place.
Right.
Right? I mean, I don't, what are
and that's right. Well, and those people aren't buying the property anymore. I mean,
they can't.
And that's why you hear about these programs to control the housing price. And these have been so misinterpreted in the U.S. People think that there's this clampdown on building and they're going to, you know, that's not what's happening. The solution to China's housing crisis, as the Chinese government sees it, is build more homes, because the demand is so significant. And the other thing to remember about China, when you look at housing bubbles in China, is that's the only place to put money. Nobody plays the stock market in Shanghai. It would be hard to find anything more fixed than the Shanghai Stock Exchange. There is no bond market to invest in. The only place to invest your money is, as Carlos said, a physical asset. You know, so that's what drives it. It's pretty extraordinary.
Thank you. Having been an exporter to Asia for many years, originally to Korea, then to Taiwan, and finally into mainland China, we've seen an evolution of the economies as they grow, and they each one of these countries decide we're no longer going to be the dumping ground of low-grade material. I totally agree with Bob and Adam that we're seeing the end of China as the recipient of our electric motors, of our insulated wire, and other low-grade products. My question to all of you is, where are we going next?
Excellent question. Carlos?
India. You know the number?
I disagree.
Yeah. Not in the short term. I'm thinking about the long term. In India, there is, according to official statistics, there are 340 million people without electricity. And probably, in some African countries, the percentage of the population without electricity is even bigger. So I'm not thinking about next year. I'm not thinking about 2 years. I'm thinking about a year similar to the period that took you move from exporting to Korea to moving to China, no? Maybe 20 years.
I think that every economy, as it matures, and we see it, the quality of the scrap that it buys goes up in a proportion to GDP growth. Okay, so you don't buy little widgety motors or things like that to take apart because it's too expensive. You mechanize it. The question is, you know, where does the scrap go next? I don't know. Certainly, it will find its way to China in possibly a different form. I don't agree with Carlos that it's going to India. I think there is no new China. That is a once-in-a-millennium occurrence, and we're in the throes of it now, but there's no new China.
I agree.
I'm talking about the
media. I have a question. Yeah. A combination for Carlos and Adam. At the IZA, International Zinc Association meeting that I recently attended, there was a discussion about how the Chinese government and its efforts to hit that 8%, hit that 9% GDP growth, was funding provincially buildings. Now, we're not talking about ghost cities. They were talking about zinc production plants, and that there was this large capacity of zinc production that was put in place in areas where they said it made no logistical sense. The raw materials were not going to come there, and they were just going to sit, and it's just going to look like a big overcapacity. So my question for Carlos would be, did something like that happen in this wire rod? You showed that huge amount of overcapacity that's sitting there. And a follow-up would be to Adam, is the zinc thing right? Is that correct? That they built plants just for the sake of building them so that they could keep the GDP going, keep the construction going?
21 years ago, I was working for the Chilean Ministry of Mines. And they asked me to prepare a proposal to build a copper smelters in Chile. So we asked the investment banks, and we show our numbers. We had a 7% yield on our investment in a 25-year period. And they told us, guys, we only fund you if you give us 12% yield. So the productivity of capital was not enough for us to build this Chilean smelter, even if it was at the side of the mine. Yeah. It's the same in China. I don't think the productivity of the capital is a variable driving the investment. It's a different decision. It's an oversupply of capital. Yeah? So you need to allocate in different uses. Yeah? And one of the uses that has been defined is the development of a metallurgical industry. My perception is that in the next 5 years, the people in charge will focus in different things, more green China, more environmental technology things, yeah, or maybe not. But I don't think we'll continue growing in the metallurgical way as has been doing in the last 15 years, yeah, or maybe with the slow down the speed. I see with the copper smelters now, yeah. So I think the allocation of capital might change. The speed of change is impossible to know to me, but now the investment over the GDP is 50%. You cannot sustain that.
Just on the zinc question, I don't know, but I don't know the answer to that, but there was, starting in 2008, a stimulus program that was especially taken advantage of by the aluminum smelters, who were told to upgrade their technology, and instead what they did was they basically duplicated the plants they had, and the rumor is that money was circulated into back pockets and did a lot to help out local governments. And that's something that happens a lot in building of industrial facilities in China. I mean, a large portion of the consumers of your scrap are state-owned entities, and their number one goal isn't always making profits. Sometimes their goal is saying that they have the biggest plant in the world, and that's how you get promoted within the Communist Party. So that's another subject altogether.
We have time for just one more question. Matt?
Hi. Adam, you showed us a little chart. My question's going to be for Carlos. And the air quality was the real air quality reported by the embassy versus what was reported by the government was more than 50% off. And Carlos, you had mentioned to us, you said, well, we use these numbers because we use these numbers. Do you use the numbers and the statistics you're getting from China? Do you use them because that's all that's available, or are they really reliable yet?
Well, I would separate the answer. On the environmental quality, well, I have nothing to say. Just to say that I saw cities in South America with a lot higher level of pollution than the one that he showed. So now in relation to the quality of the numbers, I trust the number because we do the surveys with people in China, and we go plant by plant. And there's a big difference between talking with a Chinese plant manager or an American or European plant manager, is that they release you their numbers, yeah, straight. and you can check how much refine and how much scrub they've been using. And they're quite proud of it. So I go plant by plant with the numbers that I manage. Yeah? So I can do better than that. So I trust these numbers.
I want to thank, on behalf of ISRI, I want to thank our panel for the time and their effort and their comments today, and thank all of you for coming and for your great questions.